right, everybody, we're going to get started. If everybody could come and take a seat, and we're going to start this up. I'm getting a thumbs up that we're recording. Yeah?
Correct.
Awesome. All right, good evening, everybody. My name is Alex Ross. I am going to be your MC this evening. Welcome to the February 3rd edition of Drupal NYC. Yes. I'm just going to skip right over that. I had my joke in my head already, and I forgot it. I don't know what it was. Oh, it was something that the groundhog saw its shadow, so 6 more weeks of bug fixes, something. I forgot it. All right. So here we go. We're going to get started. Housekeeping, a couple of quick things for those of you who haven't been at one of the meetups at this facility before. There are restrooms here. The women's restroom is stage left down that hallway, all about halfway down the long hallway. The men's restroom is stage right, that room down there, about halfway down. So that's important for everyone to know. Please mute all of your devices. If you have your phone that's not on silent, please put it on silent. If you have a pager, I will ask you why you still have a pager. But please do put that on silent or vibrate or something that doesn't interrupt our presenters this evening. During the evening, there are going to be various points where you're going to want to ask questions of the presenters or of me or of whoever. Please, if you're asking questions, try and flag somebody down who will be in the back with a handheld mic that looks suspiciously like the one in my hand. Because we are recording, and we want to make sure that questions get recorded as well, so that anyone who watches this at a later date can know what in the world is going on. Awesome. So this is our agenda for the evening. So 6 p.m. was in the past. The doors did in fact open. We did in fact socialize, and we have in fact eaten pizza. Well done, everybody. 6:30 has also passed, and we are in fact doing announcements. So that's going really well. We're going to do some quick introductions in a minute, and you'll get to meet your neighbors. And then we have 3 talks this evening. What do we have? We have 3 talks, and we'll talk about what the talks are in a minute because I had them in my head, but Scott totally ruined my rhythm, and now I've completely forgotten what they are. Finally, afterwards, when we're done at around 8:45, we typically go downstairs to Bill's Bar. Bill's Bar, you enter on 51st Street, and usually we are in the downstairs bar. Occasionally, they forget, and we're in the upstairs bar at Bill's Bar. But please do join us for that. It's just fun. You can network with people. You can talk with people. You can get a drink. You can have a burger. Do whatever it is you want to do. Good times after the event at Bill's Bar. Click. Okay, here we go. So the talks. So our first talk is going to be given by Nikhil, and it's on visual regression testing and Drupal. So that'll be great. I know that he was practicing it at New Jersey Drupal Camp, right? Yeah. Just last week. So he was practicing for the big presentation here, which is... That joke didn't land at all. That didn't work. Jacob Rakowitz didn't talk about YAML and what it's good for, part 3. I heard part 1 and 2 were awesome, so part 3 hopefully will be equally good. And we're going to have an introduction to GraphQL by Preston, though I hadn't seen Preston.
Preston, there you are.
Hey, Preston. So Preston is here, and we'll be giving that talk later on, which is great. Tonight's organizers, so the reason we put this up is we want to say thank you to everybody who's helping to organize, and we also want to make sure that everybody in the room knows who the organizers are, so that if you have questions, comments, concerns, jokes, poems, haikus, you can come up and let us know those things throughout the evening or after the evening or at another time and whatnot, but those are all of your organizers. Most of them are around the room right now. I'm cutting out a little bit, aren't I? Yeah. Because I said earlier, when I talk, I don't usually cut out on the mic. I actually use those words. And now I'm cutting out every, 6th word. Okay. A couple more things. The venue and the food and drinks have been sponsored by NBCU Technology. They've been super generous in giving us this great space and getting pizza and drinks for everybody. So we want to thank them. Thank you. And they're in the... If you didn't notice them conspicuously hidden back there, as you walked in, please do come visit the NBCU Technology talent acquisition folks and let them know that that you want to be acquisitioned. Awesome. There we go. A couple, did you know this meetup has official NBC pages? I haven't seen them tonight, but we do technically have official NBC pages for this meetup. Also, as I mentioned before, we do record these, so just bear that in mind as you think of things to say. Scott, I'm looking at you. And if you want to come and take a look at the recording at a later date, you can always go to drupal.nyc/videos. I also like to kind of come up with some interesting fact about the venue, and I found one today, which is when Rockefeller Center was built, it was the first major building to use air conditioning. Who knew? So there's your interesting fact. Did you know that? No, you didn't. Now you do. Okay. Photos. We definitely will have people taking photos. I got one person to smile at that. That was Eric in the back. Thanks, Eric. We will be taking photos throughout the evening. We encourage all of you to take photos as people are presenting, as people are, you know, doing their thing. If you take photos, please make sure that you share it with the hashtag DrupalNYC. You can do that on meetup.com or on Instagram or on Twitter or whatever, but hashtag DrupalNYC is what we're always looking for. So please, you know, share. Questions, comments? No? Okay, great. A quick announcement about some upcoming events that are going on. We have coming up this weekend the Drupal Global Training Day at Stony Brook out on Long Island. That is, that's this weekend, February 5th. So head out to Long Island. Friday? Well, Friday is the weekend. Let's all be honest with each other. It's Friday. DrupalCon Asia, if anybody has some extra miles that they want to use, is February 18th to 21st, which is like in 2 weeks, so nothing like traveling, you know, at the last minute to Asia. Drupal NYC Play Day, so this is a monthly play day that we have in the Drupal NYC community. Phase 2 is generously sponsors that at their offices here in New York. If you go to meetup.com/DrupalNYC, you will be able to find out more details about that. But the play day is Robbie Holmes' secret plan to get people who are kind of beginners to be more intermediate and get people who are intermediate to be more advanced. It's a great opportunity to go and just kind of sit down with somebody. You know, you have your code that you're working on and you want someone to take a look at it. You know, someone will be there who usually will be able to help you. And you can help the person next to you with whatever their code issue is that they're having. So definitely take a moment and consider coming to one of the play days. We have those every month. There's the Drupal NYC Happy Hour, which usually takes place at the House of Brews. You can find out about that on the meetup.com/DrupalNYC as well. That's going to be Wednesday, February 24th. That is usually on the last Wednesday of the month. So if you're ever like sitting and looking at your calendar going, huh, it's the last Wednesday of the month. What should I do today? There's usually a Drupal NYC Happy Hour. That is just, you know, good time with good people. You can go, you can, you know, have some drinks, talk with folks. You don't have to talk about Drupal, but you can, right? Drupal optional. But it is good people, so definitely check that out one of these days. And then, of course, we have Drupal Camp NYC coming up. That's going to be on February 27th at John Jay College. So there's the link right on there, which is groups.drupal.org/node/492773. That's right. Go check that out. But it's going to be great, and I think we have a slide coming up, and I'm going to ask Joe to come up for 2 seconds and talk about it. How about that? Joe Bahana, everybody.
It's a good thing they've got the air conditioning running today because I was getting really warm. I'm Joe Bahana. I wrote a couple of things out. First off, you don't have to remember the node number to get information. If you just type drupalcamp.nyc, it'll get you there. But first off, it's the camp is going to start promptly at 9 a.m. on the Saturday, the 27th. It's an unconference format. So how many people here have been to an unconference? A couple of you. So what is an unconference? It's basically a peer-to-peer way of creating a conference. The attendees together decide what sessions will be held within 4 distinct tracks, and those are site building, theming or design, DevOps, and a developer's track. In addition to those 4 tracks, we're going to have a Drupal 8 training session held by Alex himself in the main auditorium. And we're going to have another room that will serve as a mentoring or Drupal ladders room where people, you can come in with your projects. If you have any questions, it's just a great way to help, you know, get over a problem. So the focus of this on conference is Drupal 8. Obviously, if attendees want to go over anything associated with Drupal 7, because it's more of a consensus thing at 9 a.m., come there early. So for that hour, we'll talk about what we're going to do, but generally we're focusing on Drupal 8. So we have four track coordinators. Eric Saad is our coordinator on DevOps. So if anybody wants to talk with him during a break about some ideas you have, Father Sean, who couldn't make it tonight, is doing the dev track. I'm happy to give you his email if you want to throw him some ideas. Ray Saltini, who I don't think is here. Is Ray here? He's coordinating the site building track. And then there's a, I need a coordinator for the theming or design track. Ideally somebody who's already been working with Drupal 8 and Twig. If there's anybody here who fits that bill, just come talk with me afterwards. There's a lot of people who are here right now who are going to be presenting at the camp as well. So I'm getting more and more excited about it. A couple more points before I run out of time. Sponsors. We've landed some really great and generous organizations. They include FFW Agency, Johnson & Johnson, Averity, and DPCI. The Drupal Association is a fiscal sponsor. What that means is all monies go directly to the Drupal Association, and they manage everything from the legal to everything for us. But if your company was not named on that list, please see me on a break, or you could actually go right over here and click on a sponsor. So try to convince your business directors. It's only $500 and $1,000. And actually, for the premium sponsorship, you get five seats at the camp for that. So that's it for sponsorship. Second is registrations through Eventbrite. We're expecting over 200 attendees, and there are no last-minute registrations. So John Jay College requires us to get them to the security list a couple of days in advance, so consider that. And also consider we have to order a lot of food and stuff beforehand, so we'd love to get headcounts as early as possible. So please do. You could even register online right now. It's a fairly responsive interface. And then finally, we need some day of, well, it's Drupal 8. We built the site in Drupal 8, so it's responsive. But we need some day of volunteers just to help. Mostly it's going to be front-loaded at 7:30. We need help just setting up the food and just setting up like the rooms and everything. So a woman named Deirdre Wyeth, I don't know if she's here, she's coordinating that. But if anybody, again, wants to help, come see me or email joe@bahana.com, and it'll be really great if you could help us. Does anybody have any questions? Thank you for your time.
Awesome. Thank you, Joe. So everybody who's here should come and bring two friends, and then it's going to be awesome. Okay. Okay, interested in speaking. So generally, we do these monthly, and we always have some great speakers, and we're always looking for more great speakers. So if you are interested in giving a lightning talk or an in-depth talk, please make sure to come up to Ben, who's standing in the back over there. This is Ben. Wave to the folk people, Ben. That's Ben. Or you can always get Ben. His email address is right up there, javons@gmail.com. If you have an idea for a talk that you would like to hear, right? Those are also really, that's really good feedback for Ben as he kind of goes out into the world and looks for people to talk. So please make sure that you give those suggestions to him as well. That's the best way to get feedback so we know what kind of talks we should be doing or not doing. So please make sure that you talk to Ben or really any of the organizers, but Ben kind of heads that up. Please volunteer to speak. Tell us what you have to say. Recently, we sent out a summary. So this is just a quick update on the summary. We haven't gone through all of the data in very much detail yet, but we did want to put up some interesting information. We sent out this survey to anyone of the 1,300-some-odd people who've been active in the last 6 months. And of those, of those who we emailed, we got about a 10% response rate. Interestingly, we got some contradicting information, which is always interesting, that most people said that they were interested in intermediate skill or higher in terms of the things we should talk about, but also nearly 90% of people say that they come to the meeting to learn something new and, anyway. If you are interested in seeing all that raw data, please go to drupal.nyc/survey-results. You can take a look at some of that raw data. If you take a look at it and you feel like you want to, add to the feedback, please do that and go to drupal.nyc/feedback, and you can give us even more feedback, even if it's not included in that particular survey, but we will be doing those surveys from time to time to try and improve these meetups and, you know, kind of make them as awesome as they can possibly be. So that's just a quick sum up. We'll probably have more details about this in the coming weeks and months. Okay, Elijah is looking for a volunteer to help put these recordings up on YouTube. He has some fairly advanced requirements, so if you have some fairly advanced... No, he doesn't have advanced requirements anymore. He gave up on that. He's shaking his head. No, not advanced. Nothing advanced.
Hi, guys.
No, you're not on.
Hi, guys. It's not the technical thing I talked about last time. It's just somebody who can, like... I'll edit the videos, and I just want somebody to, like, go put all the links in and all that stuff, and then I want to split up all the talks out of the videos too. So it's like four or five videos. You gotta enter the metadata. It's not technical, but it's time consuming. And I don't have time to do it.
I'm told to swap mics because this one cuts out differently. Okay. So yes, if anybody wants to volunteer to help out with the video recordings in general, please do see Elijah. That brings us to the who is hiring and who's looking portion of the evening. Who is hiring? Please raise your hand if you're hiring people. Stand up. If you're hiring, stand up so everyone can see, right? You people are hiring, yes. We're going to run around real quick, and we're going to give your 20-second pitch.
So, forlovers.com, we sell grain spirits online, like whiskey for whiskey lovers, for tequila lovers. And we're Drupal shop right now. We're using some UberCart. We're now using some Drupal Commerce. We need theming. We need programming. Need to get our game on.
That sounds like an alcohol sponsor to me.
I work for constructive.co. We really like whiskey. We've got some big projects. We mostly do nonprofit and higher education. And we're looking either for full-time or contract workers.
Here we go.
I'm not looking to hire somebody, but I have... recently started a social action project. I'm a geneticist, and there's now enough definitive information to show that there's basically no such thing as racial differences, and basically we're fighting racism. So we now have several world-leading geneticists, including one Nobel laureate, contributing to this project. So I'm also a Drupal developer. I've been developing Drupal sites for genomics, and I need help. I've been using Panoply, but I need to put some fairly sophisticated permissions into this, and I'm trying to decide whether to switch to OpenAtrium. There are problems with OpenAtrium. I'm trying to use responsive Bartik, and it's white screening. So if somebody is anybody very familiar with the distinction between Panoply and OpenAtrium here? Okay. Well,
let's do this. It sounds like we're looking for some volunteer to help with your project. Okay, so if anybody's interested in volunteering, please come and ask questions. Okay? Perfect, so there's a couple links on the meetup and Drupal.nyc. Okay, who is looking to be hired? Raise your hands. No, yes, one. Sell yourself. You got 20 seconds. Go.
Okay, so I'm mostly just interested in front-end development for Drupal or WordPress. I was doing Drupal work not too long ago, about 8 months ago, at my company, and they moved me over to working with WordPress. So as of today, I am available.
All of the above.
All of the above.
All right. Full-time, part-time, all of the above. Okay. Is anybody else looking? All right. Moving right along. Good job, everybody. Thank you. Who's hiring? Who's looking? Tell your friends, tell your bosses, tell your neighbors that we do this every month so that they will want to come and, right, kind of advertise a little bit, get some interest. Okay. Introductions. So a million years ago, we would actually go around the room and we would have every single person stand up or talk into the mic at least real quick and say who you are, what your name was on Drupal.org, where you work, what you're interested in, whether you are, you know, what your sign is, whatever it is. But that would take about 12 years. So we've modified this recently. It's been working out really well. So everybody, we're going to take 3 or 4 minutes. I know it says 5 minutes up there, but 3 or 4 minutes quickly becomes 5 minutes. Turn to the person on your left and turn to the person on your right. Introduce yourself. What is your name? What are you interested in? What sort of, you know, things? And introduce yourself. Get to know somebody new. And go. Welcome, welcome. Hello, welcome. We're introducing ourselves to each other. Find someone to say hi. Is he? All right, everybody. And scene. It worked. Fantastic. All right, everybody. We're going to keep on going. I hope that you introduce yourself to someone interesting. I hope someone interesting introduced themselves to you. Okay. Sorry, I was just clearing my throat. So we're gonna start with our talks now. Before we start with our talks. After this talk, I am going to be going out into the entry lounge area over there and do a quick newbie boff for those who have not been here before. A newbie boff is a birds of the feather boff, and basically I go out there and people come and they ask me questions about how to get involved in the community, how to get their sites up and running, what technologies they need to use, why this module is better than that module. Why should I, you know, use Drupal instead of something else on this particular project or not? Basically, it's an opportunity for you to just get into anything very, very specific that you have on your mind. So please do come visit me out in there. We're going to have this talk. I'm going to introduce the next person, and I'm going to go out in there and let everybody know that that's where I'll be. So that will be the newbie boff. Okay. Moving right along to our first talk, please welcome Nikhil Dubaka. Yes, am I pronouncing it right? Yes. He's going to be doing a visual regression testing and Drupal presentation. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but basically, like, how do we make sure that change that you just made to your website didn't break the entire look and feel of the site somewhere else? So he's going to go over some good stuff there. Nikhil recently moved here from Boston, so hopefully he's already a Yankees fan or... No. Or he goes back, basically, yeah. And there he was a Drupal lead at edX, and he goes by Technique, T-E-C-H-N-I-K-H, on Drupal.org and Twitter. So if you want to get in touch with him after this meetup, you can do that there. And take it away, Nikhil. We're going to switch your computer to, we're going to switch, there we go. It's going, it's happening. It's going to be, there it is. Awesome.
Thanks, Alex.
You want this mic?
Or do you... I need to type sometimes. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Cool. So yeah, as Alex mentioned earlier, I was talking about the same topic last week at New Jersey Camp. That was like 45 minutes, and now I have 10 minutes, so I'll try to... some. Stop me if it's fast, too fast. So yeah, that's me. And yeah, as Alex was mentioned, I just moved from Boston to New York, and I'm looking for opportunities over here. So if you know of any cool Drupal opportunity, stop me. So I'll quickly go through this. Why visual testing? This I have taken the snapshot from Drupal.org homepage or the download page. As you can see, this is black color, and let's say Dries has asked the junior developer to change that black color to blue color. The developer goes in, sees that it's a H2, goes to CSS, and adds that color blue. The page looks good. It's deployed to prod, it's live on Drupal, and boom, homepage is broken. Build something amazing that was in white, now Drupal is not amazing. So why did it happen? Because, I mean, in the first place, it was a H2, a good developer shouldn't target it based on that, should target it deep enough. And as you see, even the homepage subtitle slogan is using H2, and that's why it changed to blue color. And this is this would have caught if we were doing visual testing on the home page along with the page that you were modifying. But it's hard, like let's say Drupal, right? It has thousands of pages on the site. It's hard to do it manually. And there are good reasons to do automation. One is this, because not all things you can test manually. It's good to do some automation. So I have written a module called Drillenium. It's on Drupal.org. I just combined like Drupal and Selenium. People who haven't heard about Selenium, it's a browser automation suite, and I'll go through it in a bit in the demo. And this helps you in automating the visual tests. The concept is simple. Like, so before you make changes, you will tell the system to take screenshots of the web pages using some tools that will go to your web page and take the screenshot. And you make your changes after the screenshots have been done, like site upgrades, or just like in the previous case, making CSS change. And after you make the change, you will take you will tell the system to take another set of screenshots. And then the system will calculate the difference between the first screenshot, the base version, and the new version. There are so many image manipulation tools, so like Image Magic, you can calculate the difference between image pixels, or you can generate an animated GIF out of it. So when you look at the GIF, you will clearly see what changed from the old versus the new. Like this. This is the baseline image. It's in small letters. And the new version, you made a change to capital letters. The diff, the system will show a diff that in this region, something has changed. And if you look at this is a GIF animation. So when you see the difference is that one version has this link show all columns. I think I took it from Drupal 8 administrator. So now time for this quick demo. So I have like two pages here. I'm logged in. One is an NYC page and one is Boston page. Not sure why I chose red for Boston. But yeah, as you can see, we have the NYC and the Boston page. And let's say the business requirement, some product manager has asked you to change this color to red. So the developer goes to color, sees that's title and slogan. I'm changing it to red. So the developer has changed this, and boom, it looks nice as required. Not nice, but yeah, as required. So now the automation comes in. If the developer has not done the testing and has deployed it, as you know, this white color would also have turned red and it wouldn't look nice. So this is the module that I was talking about, Drillenium. I'll not create the test. I will use an existing test that I have already created. So I have created for the NJ camp. I'll quickly go through the test. So I have created this test. I mean, it's a form where you configure. So here I'm saying that first in the test, I have to click a button. So I have targeted using CSS that the test, the automation has to go to the browser to this Boston page, NYC page, and click on this button and hover over this element. Like click on this button, take screenshot and hover over this element just for demo purposes. That's what I have configured this test. Click button, take screenshot. Don't take the screenshot of the whole page. It's only taking the screenshot of the top banner. And I have done that using CSS code here to target the element that I want. And after taking the screenshot, it will just hover over that this element. And I will show you how this automation happens. So let's say I want to run this test. I'm going to test, run. So this is the demo test. I want to do a visual regression test on it. So I'm saying that I want to name it NYC Meetup Demo, not the base release, but I have created a base release already, so I'll just create a new release. So it's going to this the same site, which is in my local, and I'm telling it to log in as admin user to do the testing just because the Boston and New York pages are restricted and anonymous users can't access. This automation will go to that page, log in, and then test as an admin user. So I'm telling it to take snapshot. I'll show you a terminal log. What's happening is a fire in the backend. I have installed Selenium on my local, and in the backend, the Firefox browser is being launched. And so I'm not touching anything. As you can see, it goes to the page. It goes to the login page because I told it to log in. It's typing those username and password that I entered. And watch carefully. It's clicking on that button, taking the snapshot, and hovering over, and taking the snapshot again. It's doing the same thing on two pages. I'm out of time, so I'll just go quickly. So now that we have the set of snapshots after the release, I'll just compare the things that I did before demo and this. So in the backend, I am using Image Magic to generate this highlighted diff and the animated GIF. So as you can see here, it took the screenshot of just the banner, and it's showing a comparison between the base release, which was white in color, and the new release, which was red in color. So yeah, it has several features. I'll quickly go through a couple of them. So one is I have configured several things here, like local. You can test using the local Selenium server if you have time and capability to install Selenium and Image Magic on your system. Or you can pick remote Drillenium server. What happens is you will send all the information to my Drillenium server that will take the screenshots and will email you when everything is ready for you to look at. Or we have Sauce Labs server where you can buy this Sauce Labs account from Sauce Labs and put those details here, username, access key, and which browser you want to test. And all the screenshot taking will be happening in Sauce Labs for you. Nothing to do with me. It's vendor free. So the advantage with Sauce Labs is that you can test across multiple browsers, multiple operating systems, and multiple versions. The other thing is, when you use Sauce Labs and when you can't install Image Magic on your system, you can use GitHub to do the image comparison stuff. Here, GitHub has cool ways to compare images. Like you can see, if you swipe, when you drag the slider, you can see what is the difference between the base and the new. So even you don't need to host the images. GitHub will do it for free at this point. And there are these are multiple plugins. I have shown them about clicking buttons, screenshot, and hover over. But you can do all this fill text box and all that stuff. And the cool thing is you can import and export these tests or modify them. It's based on C-Tools presets, so you can use features to export it. It has Drush integration too, so you can just say that after a GitHub deployment, you could run these tests automatically instead of clicking the button. And it has integration with Eiger and DevShop too, so you could integrate that whole automation, like taking the screenshots and everything using these Eiger modules that I linked. There are other tools for this, all this visual regression testing. One cool thing is show.io. That's kind of Drupal specific, so check it out if you want to know more about other tools in this area. And I don't think I have time for other things, but yeah.
That's true.
Yes.
Wait, don't go yet. Don't go yet. No? There we go.
Hi. Does anybody have any quick questions for Nikhil? We have one question right there.
Hi. I have a question. So all the tests are just done through comparison of screenshots, or can you also, I noticed there were buttons there for verifying elements. Can you make tests that essentially do assertions and pass and fail?
It can do the verify text present or those kind of things too. So it can, currently it's not that supported.
Right.
In Sauce Labs or in local, the backend is Selenium, so it's possible to do it.
Right.
The current thing that's happening is all client side. If you know, there's a Selenium add-on in Firefox where you can run these things locally. So that's what it does. Those plugins that you see, it will generate a Selenium script when you do this configuration, and you can tell the Selenium add-on to do that test.
Then go in and alter the script that is created.
Right. And yeah, the possibility is that it can also run through Sauce Labs and stuff in the future. That's in the roadmap that I want to do.
Okay, thanks.
Awesome. One more question. All right, thank you very much, Nikhil. Woo! All right, come on up. I don't think it switched to the right screen, but in the meantime, we're going to have our next presenter is Jacob Rakowitz. He's going to be presenting on YAML, What Is It Good For? Part 3. Jacob is a consultant who's been working at MSKCC for the past, for 15 years at MSKCC. Wow. He's been working with Drupal for 7 years, and with the help of Phase 2, has pushed MSK to become one of the earliest adopters of Drupal 8. So here we go. Jacob, take it away.
Okay. I got to point it up. I need a screen. Okay. It's part 3 because I could do a much longer presentation.
Can I do this?
Yeah, that would be if it works. Yes. As long as this won't squeak. You can take this guy away. Yeah, that works.
I'm just going to head out there for the newbie buff. Okay.
Part 3, because I could do a much longer presentation about YAML, and I have all this other... we did a huge project. I'm going to start the presentation and show you. Namesake did a huge project with Sohn Kettering. We ported them to Drupal 8. They were an early adopter. Drupal 8 was very challenging to learn, but I think it's an amazing platform. And just to give you the most important detail about that project is it started on Alpha 3. So we did... We built everything from scratch. There were no contrib modules available. It worked out fine because of the APIs in 8. You were able to kind of do creative solutions to problems, and I'm going to get to some of those. So this quote came up. Daredevil series was on Netflix, and this quote sat with me because I'll just read it. Problems are just opportunities that haven't presented themselves, and I felt like that. I kept running into that while doing this project, being like, we don't have a module. What are we going to, there's no module for this. What are we going to do? How are we going to solve it? And YAML kept coming up. I kept using it to solve different problems. I'm going to get to a big problem in a little bit. I'm going to start off with just what is YAML, because I think it's a new piece of technology that's in Drupal 8. They say YAML ain't another markup language, or that's the way they're presenting it. It is a markup language. It's a very simple markup language. It's just plain text. I think the concept behind it, and I haven't read too much on the origins, it's just like XML and JSON is just hard to read. You can't quickly edit them. And one of the requirements in Drupal 8, they wanted to make config easy to edit. And it's a very readable format. On the right in the yellow is my personal information written out in YAML, and it's just name value pairs. The dash represents an array. And I'll move ahead a little bit. How do you learn YAML? So I presented YAML as a user interface. I created config files and I gave them to editors and I said, you've got to go edit this file. And what I directed them to was Wikipedia. It has one page that describes the whole spec and is incredibly readable. And within about an hour, most reasonably intelligent people go, oh yeah, I get it. And if you have a reasonable YAML validator, it usually spits back errors with line numbers because it's actually easy to parse this and be like, you're missing a space here. So where is YAML used in Drupal 8? The most immediate thing that any module developer or any developer would see is in the module info file. And I'm just using this as an example of the starting point of where it's in D8. It's used anywhere there's information stored in a file. I can't think of any other instance. Yep, that's it. If you have information written out into a file, it's going to be in YAML in Drupal 8. So I'm going to do a live demo. I'm just kind of preparing people for this. What did I do with YAML on the MSK project? Let's just start with this concept. YAML is a user interface. UIs tend to be complex. YAML is very simple. It's just plain text. And UIs take time to build and maintain, and we had to build a lot of modules, and we had to just get it done. And sometimes it was easier just not to build the UI and just write out a YAML file that makes a lot of sense. And something about YAML, you know, using a YAML as a UI, it kind of brings up this whole concept of configuration files versus GUIs. And it's kind of like the Unix versus Windows thing, where if you know what you're doing, configuration files are really easy. You can get things done fast and efficient. And you can even archive it. And you can back it up and share it. With a GUI, it can slow you down. Important about editing YAML and like the stuff I've done, Code Mirror makes it a lot easier. It's just a browser-based text editor. It's being used everywhere. Anywhere you go, like in Bitbucket, and you go to edit a file, it'll open up a Code Mirror editor. It's kind of like the CK editor equivalent to editing code. I know this concept's kind of like, what am I talking about? I'm getting there. So here's the problem that we had to face. We needed a form and survey builder for Drupal 8. And the web form module was and is still not available for Drupal 8. There's a lot of stuff going on with it, but it just wasn't there. So MSK needed a web form builder. That was their requirements. They needed to build forms, collect data, export the data. That's the core of their, like, it was just a key thing. So some concept is form API, that's how forms are built in Drupal, is very stable and mature. Actually, in Drupal 8, there were not a lot of changes to form API itself. There was some restructuring of it, but the concept of how it worked, which is render arrays, stayed pretty much the same. And then what a render array, and this is hard to explain these concepts, there's three concepts, form API and render array. Render array is just the way Drupal describes information. It's a PHP array that describes the properties of a form input. I'll show you an example in a second. And then the fundamental concept that kind of inspired me was, you could take these kind of confusing-looking PHP arrays and convert them to YAML, and suddenly they become easy to read. And it created this question, could we build forms using YAML? And this is what I'm talking about. This is the example. So here's a contact form written in YAML for Drupal 8. This is what didn't ask these questions of who's built forms before, but if you built a form in Drupal 8, this is a very simple concept. It's, you're setting your properties. Like the first element is a name. The pound symbol represents, like, here's the title of this element, and the type would render a text field. And I'm going to demo this. So I'm going to show you what's going on. To start off, this is a module called YAML form. It is on D.O. The page has a lot of documentation, and you can spin this up on Simply Test Me very easily and test it. It's self-contained. There's very few dependencies. Now I'm going to demo it. Okay. This is the starting page. By the way. This is the high, low, can I get this resolution sharper? Does anyone know? Yeah, no, as long as it'll support it.
It's 1080p by default.
Okay, let's go for it.
1080i actually.
Much better. There we go. I can live with that.
We just upgraded.
Sorry about that, guys. Yeah, look at this. Now it's much better. It's a little small, but I don't think that matters that much. And I can actually make this bigger. And we're good to go. Sorry, guys. Okay, so the module is already installed to kind of speed up the demo. One of the concepts I have compared to other form builders is I'm starting with defaults. I'm starting with kind of three concepts. I'm giving you a contact form to start with, which is what I'm going to use for a demo, and some examples, which I will show, and then templates, One of the patterns I've seen with form builders is people just copy forms to create other forms, and I'm trying to make this more efficient. I'm going to just show you the contact form. Here's that YAML, and I'll show you the YAML rendering a contact form. It actually has some extra properties like a default value, and it actually down here you're going to see this pound test, which is a custom thing that I did to make it possible to test forms on the fly, and I'll show you a test to this. So there's a tab called test. It's only for developers, but it will just populate the form on the fly so you can quickly test your form and generate some test data. And actually, in the back end, there's ways to generate test data sets that you can use to test incredibly long forms with any data you want. Show that it works. I'm going to hit send. Sorry, my clicking is not great. So this is based off of a lot of concepts in web forms. So anyone familiar with web forms is going to see a lot of similarities. For example, I'm going to start with results just to show you. This is mirrored off of web forms. I'm collecting the data. I'm presenting it in a table. I can show you the data. You can. I also added a plain text view to get people more familiar with that. And there's also a YAML view because the data is being stored in the database as YAML. I just did that because I like YAML. It makes things easier. And it actually opens up this possibility that you can filter your data really easily. You can do, if I go to the table view, you can search through any piece of data here. So if I type ORA, it's going to pull up all the submissions by this name. Export just allows you to export into a spreadsheet. I'm going to jump back up to the form for a quick second, click edit, and just be like, here's the main page where you can edit it. The settings, everything's customizable. It's kind of one of the, this is a developer tool, so I'm trying to make it as flexible as possible. So every label you can customize. If you go to the admin settings page, you can customize the default of every label. Out of the box, it's including drafts, previews. It's up to about 80% feature, 70 to 80% feature parity of what people are familiar with form builders. One important feature, also, it has a full array of access controls, so you can control any aspect of how people access submissions if you want someone. One important thing, I'll make a statement. If you're building these forms, you should be a developer because you have full, it's unlimited capabilities here with these form, this form builder, because you can do anything you can do in a render array. You can build any layout, anything you want, and I'll give you kind of a more concrete example of that. And finally, it does do emails. One interesting thing, D8 has a new plugin system, and it's sending emails, but it's using a plugin. And the idea that behind this plugin is it's an abstract, I'm calling it like a handler, a YAML form handler. And the idea behind this is it takes the data as it comes in, and you can do whatever you want with it. So people can extend this and build plugins to do a MailChimp. I'm actually working on creating an interface, like a sender interface, so we could do SMS messaging or anything we want. And you can just stack these handlers into this, into the submission processing. Out of the box, it does store submissions, and you can also turn that off and point this to another service to store your submissions, like a web service or a Google Doc. So it kind of becomes a tool to just manage your forms. It doesn't have to store your data. Jumping back up, I just want to show the full capability. So it does ship with examples. I'm just going to show you my kitchen sink example. This is an example of every single form element available in core. It gets really interesting when you do this because file uploads are, I actually was able to get file uploads supported and NT references supported out of the box. You get a WYSIWYG editor, you have the table select, and I'm going to just quickly show you the markup for this. You know, I'm just including references to the documentation, but it gives you good starting points to cut and paste and build your own forms. Finally, it does, so YAML forms are entities, and what that does is it opens up where you can embed these on anything on the site. I need a little sip. The most common scenario that people talk about is doing a block, and I'm going to just quickly show that demo. Sidebar. I'm going to stick to the contact form example. And something I've been playing with is the idea of when you're embedding something, you can set default data. I'm not going to do that right now, but the idea is you could put the form in and change some of the default values. It opens up the capability where you could take the same form and keep reusing it and be like, okay, here's the payment amount for this registration form and here's the payment amount for another. I'm going to save the block. It's added to the site. And I kind of want to show you another key concept and then I'm done. I'm going to open up two tabs, and we're going to get our contact form on the side, and I'm going to fill it out. Scroll down. I'm going to send it. And you could also create nodes that are these contact forms. I've done it. I'm going to go back into here. Sorry. By the way, it's under structure, YAML form. Not that hard to get to. Submissions. Also, all the submissions are tracked in a global way. So this is just a concept I kind of want to introduce people to because I need help figuring it out. This form got submitted in two places, and I'm actually capturing the context of where the form's coming from. So it makes the forms reusable. You know, like I kept having people copy the same form over and over, again, say, here's an event, and I want people to register for it. And they copy the form and put it at the bottom of that registration event. The idea here is you could take the same form and put it on multiple events, and it will track that information. It captures the context down to what entity you're submitting the form from and even query string parameters. There's actually the ability to pre-populate the form from query string parameters. It's done in a secure way where you have to turn it on. If you check a box, then in the query string parameters of URL, you can set any value. That is a pretty thorough demo. This thing, you guys can hop onto Simply Test Me and go through it. And I'm going to move forward. Conclusions. So, I mean, YAML, just to back up to the point of, like, YAML's great. It's simple to understand and to learn. It's everywhere in Drupal 8. It can be used to solve some difficult problems. And I guess, you know, I brought in this module that asks the question, does this solve a difficult problem for Drupal 8? What do you think? Questions?
Yeah. Thank you, Jake. Any questions?
Under 10 minutes?
No, but that's okay. Sorry. Any questions over here?
Great. Okay, so I know nothing about D8. From what I understand from your talk, WebForm still is not available. And is this, is this going to be available? Are you, is anybody considering this for forms and D8 in general?
So the status of this module, I started it just, the part three is the fact that there's a lot of background here. This concept is live on mskcc.org. It's handling about 100 forms and they're being built in YAML and we've got good performance out of it. I put the module in D.0. I'm getting some feedback, but it's in unstable in the sense of I'm still sorting out the APIs, but I'm hoping to have an alpha release in the next week or so. And I want to push it forward. I have the time and resources to do it. Web Forms is just in a very difficult state because it's a very complex module. There's a lot of politics about porting that. It is. I mean, it is a solution that we had to use to replace Web Forms.
Hey, that was amazing. whatever thing you wrote that converts the YAML to a form array, that needs to be, like, ready to go for so many reasons. And I would even try to get that in 8.2 or 8.3. It just seems like that tiny thing would make such a big difference in building these form arrays. So I don't know.
A quick note about YAML. What's missing from this demo is converting anything that's rendered. Yeah, anything to into YAML, because we had stuff with, like, links, like a list of links.
That's amazing. And that needs to be, like, everywhere, that idea. Because you're exactly right. YAML's amazing. And it's just, you can program with it. Like, why not have a form file in your module and just say Drupal get form and automatically finds that file, right, as a YAML file instead of a giant array. So many different forms are tiny.
And like, one trick that just very quickly I did do was form alters in YAML is really easy. So instead of, like, you just have a bunch of files, you catch the ID, and you just alter the forms, and it saves a huge amount of time, especially, like, exposed filters and stuff.
So I guess it's not necessarily a question, but maybe some advice to build a tiny little library that does just that part, and so that we could kind of play with it on a lot of on different levels.
There needs to be a cookbook for Drupal 8, because these are, like, these are just very simple classes. Like, there's a lot of these little classes that will just help people where they just need to cut and paste them into their custom code.
I think taking that and making that a separate class, let people pull it in.
Yeah.
But the forms thing, that's awesome. So much better than WebForm.
Thanks. Got a question right here, and then time for one more.
Jake, I'll buy your Drupal 8 cookbook. But the question I had for you is patient data. So are they using it for patient data right now, or encrypted data, or?
No, but that's exactly, so this whole abstraction of the handler and being able to turn off submissions, that's how Sloan Kettering turns off we turn off the storing of submissions and send it to a web service. And that's kind of what inspired me to be like, you have to abstract out how you handle data so that people who don't, it just makes it, opens up unlimited capabilities, because also these handlers allow you to alter things too. So you could do a payment handler where you just say, I want to add a payment handle, and it'll just alter the form and add all the credit card information below it. And it's not going to be stored. You know, you can deal with your own security.
I'm going to kind of echo what John said. I think this is a great way to transition for a lot of things because, I mean, part of the annoyances of Drupal is that you're using some web GUI and you're doing a bunch of stuff. And then at the end of the day, you still need to get it out into code to version it and all these things, right? So you're fighting to go through a GUI just to get it back out into code anyway. Why do that if you can just have it in code?
The content types and forms and everything like that in D8 now, they do export straight to YAML. So like the fields, the field settings, all that stuff gets exported. It's very different than what they did.
I want to just address that one thing because it's really valid. You can export everything. And by the way, just like the plug here, entity form and contact form, if you need to do data analysis and complex stuff, use those systems. This is not like this won't build views. You could write a plugin handler to do it, but that's not my goal. But the thing about the exporting fields, because I dealt with hundreds of fields, each one gets its own file, and it does become hard to manage. And I'm not going to go very deep into code, but I'm just going to show you something. This form, I'm going to show you the kitchen sink. Everything's stored into one file that you can edit and share, and that's kind of been a huge... Oh. Ah, bummer.
Just a second.
You're killing me. You're killing me. Okay. This is the kitchen sink. I'm going to actually go to the contact form and just show you. I spent a lot of energy making sure that this would be all in one file that's extremely readable so you could just share it. Because I personally wanted this. I really couldn't stand, like, even your handlers and all the permissions are stored in this one file and they're structured and you can tweak them and share them. And I made a couple of interesting decisions where these are really shareable. Like, I'm not using text formats because I can't tell what text formats on other people's systems. So I just felt like that pattern I wanted to get away from so that this could be copied and pasted. That's it. Oh, finally a plug. Use this module, especially the big sites. If you are comfortable manipulating data, you could use it now. Because basically the issue is if I make some change to the API, all you got to do is know what you're doing and write an update hook. This is usable, and I need help seeing it to the end. Thank you.
Thank you, Jacob. So next up, we have Preston So. Usually Alex does this part, so I'm going to go from memory. I know Preston from Colorado, where he created the Southern Drupal Users Group, Southern Colorado Drupal Users Group. And he's now presently at Acquia as lead in Acquia Labs program. So he's going to be talking to us today about GraphQL. And take it away, Preston. Thank you.
Awesome. How's it going, everybody? Those are a couple of really tough acts to follow. I mean, visual regression testing, obviously a very big topic. YAML with Drupal 8, obviously huge. Hello, I'm Preston. It's wonderful to be here. I'm based in New York, and this is Introduction to GraphQL. Before I move on, first of all, here's where it's funny because the last time I presented this, actually, I forgot to get rid of the menu bar. So if you actually go to the Badcamp recording of this same session, you'll see all of my bookmarks all lined up at the top. I'm not making that mistake this time. So thank you, Ben, by the way, for that wonderful introduction. I've been a Drupal developer since 2007. I'm currently development manager at Acquia Labs, which is a new initiative at Acquia. You might have heard of me from various Drupal cons or Drupal camps in the area. I'm a frequent speaker. And if you're a very sort of avid follower of the Drupalverse, you may also have heard of me through a very controversial issue that I posted on Drupal.org recently. Before I begin, I would love to actually get a sense of the room. How many people have worked with decoupled Drupal builds or know what decoupled Drupal is, headless Drupal? Okay, good. So a good amount of people. Obviously the whole concept of decoupled Drupal is you're using, you know, basically Drupal as a RESTful backend. And so how many of you have heard of GraphQL or have heard of React and these sort of technologies? Okay, great. So we've got a good mix of people. What I'm going to do is I'm going to offer a sort of brief introduction to the Facebook open source ecosystem as well, just so we get a full understanding of sort of what's going on. So here's what we're going to cover. The first is origins and motivations. Where did GraphQL come from? What is this? Why is everybody freaking out about GraphQL? It's just another query language. What's going on? So I'll try to sort of delve into that a little bit. GraphQL and REST. So what implications does GraphQL have on typical RESTful architectures? Now, I want to be very clear about this. I'm not talking about REST as the architectural style. I'm talking about REST as the sort of approach that many people have taken, which is namely a JSON payload-based HTTP API. So to be very clear about that. I'm not talking about Roy Fielding's concept of REST. I'm not talking about, I'm solely talking about how people typically, in these days, are approaching RESTful architectures. Third thing I'll do is to talk about GraphQL syntax, which I think is very useful to look at from the standpoint of what's going on in Drupal. I'll delve into a little bit about what makes GraphQL so powerful, which is its complete introspectability. And then I'll also talk a little bit about sort of how GraphQL could fit in, or actually already does fit in, let's say, into the larger Drupal ecosystem. Does that sound good? All right, let's get going. So, what's that? In 10 minutes. Okay, well, I didn't realize it's going to be 10 minutes. Is it?
No, you have more than 10 minutes.
I have more than 10 minutes. Okay, good. Awesome. All right. If not, this is going to be a very quick presentation. So the first thing I'll talk about is, what is GraphQL? So GraphQL, simply put, is a declarative query language and an application-level protocol. Now, you're probably thinking to yourself, this is a whole bunch of words that are just strung together. What does this actually mean? Well, so to begin, let me talk about the Facebook open source ecosystem just to get our feet wet in what are all these people actually talking about. So first, you may have heard of React. It's all the rage right now in the front-end world because of its very sort of fresh approach to state management on the client side, as well as this whole new thing that people are freaking out about and writing to their parents about called virtual DOM. So React, simply put, is a view-based component library, which means that it really serves as the view layer for what we know traditionally as MVStar, MVC, MVVM frameworks that you may have heard of if you've worked with any sort of JavaScript implementations. So the sort of key differentiator of React from other frameworks that are out there, such as Angular and Ember currently, or sorry, Angular 1, let me say, because Angular 2 is different, is that there's this thing called a virtual DOM, which is a diff-based mechanism of actually figuring out differences between two states of your UI. So for example, if you have a form that has a different render after an action takes place, instead of directly applying that manipulation onto the DOM, like jQuery or Backbone would typically do, instead, you have this abstract DOM, which lies outside of the regular DOM. And, okay, here we go. All right, can everybody, okay. Just let me know if you can't hear me or if I cut out. And basically, based on this diffing, is able to figure out how to intelligently sort of patch the page up. So to move forward from that, Relay is a framework that co-locates basically data fetching logic and React view components. So basically React is made up of components that you put together and that are nestable. And these components have to have some kind of data fetching needs. And I'll explain why in just a little bit. So what is GraphQL now that we've sort of covered those bases? Well, GraphQL is a query language that is initiated from the client side. So you write your queries from the client side. And it's completely transport and storage agnostic communication, which means that it has no dependency on HTTP necessarily. It has no dependency necessarily on its particular client-side framework. And basically what it does is very simple. You send from the client side a structure to the server, and the server responds with data that mirrors that same structure. Now, if you're thinking to yourself, wow, that's actually a pretty nifty idea. How come we didn't think of this before? It's very interesting because actually Facebook has said all along, we've been using this for years and years, actually. And we're only going to open source it now because we see the value of actually doing that. So basically, Facebook realized while it was creating its HTML5-based mobile apps and converting them into iOS and Objective-C-powered apps that really what they needed was a way to really intelligently get data from the client side. So actually, React and Relay are actually these innovations that came about after GraphQL. GraphQL has been in use at Facebook for a while. So if you have used the Facebook application on your iPhone or your Android, you've been basically sending and submitting GraphQL queries. So Nick Schrock, the creator of GraphQL, has this quote, which is, instead of placing data fetching logic in some other part of the client application or embedding this logic in a custom endpoint on the server, we instead co-locate a declarative data fetching specification alongside the React component. So this is a very important idea, which is you are specifying what data you want returned from the client side. It's not really predicated on your API spec necessarily. This is a very, very, very powerful idea, right? So basically, you've got this unified structure across the payload, and I'll show you what that looks like in just a little bit. So here's a quick introduction to React, because I know that a lot of us are not React people. But for example, let's say that we have a hierarchy of data. Now, React has this idea of view hierarchies. All client-side frameworks that are modern currently have this idea of view hierarchies, which is that inside this article component, we have the title, path, and author components. And within the author component, we have name and location. Now, here's the thing. Typically, when you write a REST API, when you write an API specification and you want to have this data made available, what you might do is you might have each of these be houses resources, such as, let's say, you have an article and you have the author. Now, the problem becomes, though, that if you have an article resource that actually doesn't return any of the metadata that comes along with author, then you're kind of out of luck. You have to go back and go all the way back to your backend, go back to your API spec and add that in, either through an ad hoc endpoint. There are lots of ways to do it, and I'm not going to delve into the RESTful part of things, but this is really hard. And Facebook realized this very quickly. They were like, we have to have two round trips to the server to get both the article information and the author information. That's kind of ridiculous. Let's just take, for example, here's a React component, and this is JavaScript syntax. And what you'll see is there's this templating language that React uses called JSX, which is basically an interpolation of HTML into JavaScript. React takes this, interprets it, and parses it into JavaScript objects. So what we're doing here is we're fetching the article path, the article title, the author name, and the author location. Now, as you can see, we actually want this stuff to be available from the article object, right? We don't want this stuff to be available as a separate object on this.props. So as a result, what we want to do is we want to structure this data in the same way on the client side. So here's our GraphQL query. So basically, assuming that you have Relay installed, assuming you have your React application, what we've got is before this, during the creation of your component, you're declaring a query which basically dictates the structure of the data you want returned. So here we've got all of our hierarchy defined. And what happens is this is the query that we're sending. And if you think about this, well, this looks a heck of a lot like JSON, right? This is pretty much JSON. And if we actually submit this query and we actually fire it, what we get is this result, which is a JSON object, which contains all of these fields that we have requested. And as you can see, the server's response actually does mirror the client's desired query, right? So if you think that's something that's back to the future, it is, because honestly, why haven't we thought of this before? Why haven't we allowed the client to dictate a lot of this stuff and prevent a lot of the friction that happens between server and client? So with that in mind, let's talk a little bit about REST. And that should actually say RESTful architectures. By the way, once again, when I'm referring to REST, I'm talking about the typical approach to RESTful architectures. So here's, a lot of people have built, RESTful Drupal. And one thing that you've probably come across is that a lot of times it's really, really hard to adhere to sort of Roy Fielding's original ideas about REST. Namely that, we have a lot of bloated responses, you have many round trips to the server, there's really no backwards compatibility, you have to do this really complicated versioning which has no semanticness and is just really confusing. It's also not introspective, right? This is a big problem with not only JSON, but also all APIs, which is a lot of APIs that we typically write today do not have any sort of introspection. There's no introspection API, which means that we have no idea what the type system looks like, we have no idea what the schema looks like, and this is a big problem. So You know, one of the big problems that I notice a lot when building RESTful Drupal and seeing people build RESTful Drupal backends is that, you know, a lot of endpoints are very specific and very tailored, right? Now, as we saw with the example of the author, you know, the article and author, this gets very hairy very quickly because, you know, relational operations, things that are, you know, that are really, you know, should be sent back in a single response are sent back in two separate responses because you've had to fire two separate requests. And also, you've got the problem of ad hoc endpoints, right? How many people have, you know, had their front-end developer say, hey, I need this data now, and I need this. But then you're like, oh, well, this endpoint is already serving this data to this client. I'm just going to, you know, provision a whole new endpoint for you so you can have your own client. Well, this gets very out of hand very quick because now you've got 15 million endpoints to actually figure out how to organize. It's a big problem. And then also, you get response bloat. So this is one of the biggest problems with the typical approach to RESTful architectures right now, which is that because of these changing requirements and because of the constantly evolving needs of our data and how it gets sent to the client side, a lot of these clients that only have limited data might have to deal with increasingly large payloads. And now if you're an IoT application, let's say, and you really want that really low, you know, small size payload that you're getting, that is not a good idea. You know, you should not be getting sent the entire Android map of data when you're a Roku application or something like that. So obviously, you know, this kind of how do you appeal to all the clients and make them all happy at the same time and also still be performant, right? This is the problem. Of course, then you have many round trips, as I said earlier. You know, if you've got a lot of complex relationships, you've got a lot of stuff going on in your actual desired response, then you know you're going to have a lot of client server round trips. And if you're using Drupal, which is not well known for its lightweight and tiny bootstrap, you will be also bootstrapping Drupal as well every time. So that delays the render. And also there's no backwards compatibility, right? REST APIs are versions typically. You'll often see people using the scheme API/v1/resource. And so what happens is that, you know, as client needs evolve, basically these versions get very, very hard to manage. You've got these sort of colossally growing list of versions. So queries have to be rewritten against the new API. You have to basically, you know, update everything everywhere. It's a big pain, right? So, and then finally, as I said earlier, there's no introspection. We can't figure out what's a valid value for this field. You know, there's no native schema. There's no formalized type system. And so this makes validation on the client side especially very difficult. Let's talk a little bit about how GraphQL solves some of these problems. Well, basically, the thing to keep in mind here, and I want to be clear because I think a lot of people have misconceptions about GraphQL. GraphQL is a specification. It's not a framework. It's not, you know, something that you can download and plug in. Drupal has to write a GraphQL server, right? Basically, what happens is you want to allow these clients to hook into Drupal and get this data. So Drupal has to manage all of this on the back end and serve the correct data. And it can do that in a single bootstrap, and it can do that in a single server round trip, assuming that you have GraphQL logic on the server side that basically handles this stuff. And I'll talk a little bit about what it means for Drupal in just a little bit. So basically, what this means is that if you have a shared endpoint that's, you know, for all of your clients, you can basically have all of the resolution of those queries happen on the server side. And also tailored responses, right? Once again, the structure of the payload that you receive actually mirrors the structure of what you sent. And a GraphQL server typically returns a single response. And that's pretty much flexible enough to accommodate a wide variety of different relationships. And I'll show you in just a little bit what that means. And of course, no matter what version of your API you have, if you have basically spaghetti versioning, you know, your client can basically provide the exact same query to multiple versions of that API. They don't have to worry about whether it's the V2 API or the V4 API or whatever. And you can expect a common response from every single one of them. And finally, GraphQL also has a very, very extensible schema and type system. Actually, it's been compared quite often to the Go type system. So why GraphQL? Why do we want to explore doing this anyway? Because as we all know, more abstraction on top of more abstraction on top of more abstraction, you know, sometimes stuff falls apart, right? Well, this is very different because what we're really doing is we're abstracting away a lot of the distinctions that make it so hard to create something like a transport agnostic or a product, you know, an application level approach to querying data. So it's a common vernacular between server and client. That's how it's been designed. And it's similar enough to JSON to be very easy to onboard. Anyone who knows, just like the last presentation with YAML, anyone who knows JSON can use GraphQL. So GraphQL, if you have a server on the service, if you have a GraphQL server that you've built, it basically prevents any unnecessary requests or bootstraps, which is really good news for Drupal. Basically, once again, the HTTP protocol is just one of many ways that you can transmit these queries. It doesn't really matter, and also the database doesn't matter, either. If you're using MongoDB or if you're using MySQL, a GraphQL server couldn't care less, right? Because that's the goal. Is we shouldn't care. So obviously I've been extolling the values of GraphQL, for hours and hours, but there are some criticisms, right? Once again, the abstraction on top of abstraction is a very bad thing. And basically you can, provision more, REST endpoints, of course. There's solutions for this during in the typical approach to REST. And of course, HTTP, people are saying, well, we're ignoring HTTP. You can have multiple parallel network requests. And HTTP2 will actually probably mitigate this to a great extent. So why do we need it in the first place? And then, of course, HTTP content negotiation, right? You can actually have all of that versioning take place through content negotiation, which means that at a single path, you can have, you don't need that API/V2 thing anymore, really. And also, HTTP has a built-in type system as well. And it can tie into things like JSON schema. I'm getting a little bogged down, so I'm going to push ahead. But if you want to get going now with this, because the Drupal module for GraphQL is not currently ready, please feel free to get going with this GraphQL server. So let's talk a little bit about syntax. Well, GraphQL models two types of operations. And I say models because it doesn't actually execute them. All that actually happens on the server. So we have a query, which is a read-only fetch, which means that you are not affecting anything when you do a read operation. Makes a lot of sense. Mutation is a write operation. It performs a write. And then nested within that write operation is a further fetch. So I'll show you how that looks when we get to mutations. So you can have named operations, which are case sensitive. And you can also have anonymous queries as well. And then basically what happens now, so this syntax has evolved a little bit. The GraphQL spec has been under heavy flux recently. Basically, originally, this was designed with comma separation. Now there is no comma separation. Basically, you have carriage return separated fields, which are basically discrete pieces of information. And as you can see, what you get back as JSON is right there on the screen. Now, fields can also describe relationships with other data. You can have nested relationships. You can have, basically the rich hierarchical a context that I described earlier with the original example. Yes.
So obviously when you're making another question, use the mic, please.
I'll just repeat the question. Go ahead.
You have to send some sort of ID, right? Mm-hmm. To get that information.
Yep.
Okay. You're gonna show that.
Yep. Yep.
It's a little confusing to see it without that in there.
Sure. Sure. Yep. So. I'm getting there in just a second, right? All this currently assumes that that there's a single thing to be selected. I haven't quite gotten there yet because it's going to be in the next slide. Here we go. Arguments. That answers your question. Oh yeah. So the question was there has to be some kind of an argument that provides the ID for what you're actually fetching. And we just got there. So there's your argument. And of course, you can apply arguments anywhere you want to. And I'll talk about how actually to define these arguments, because that's really compelling as well. And it really gives a lot of insight into the awesome level of introspection. Oh, thank you so much. The awesome level of introspection that GraphQL gives you natively if you follow the spec. So let's go ahead and push forward. So as you can see, we're fetching the 72x72, that avatar from the CDN. And we basically got all of our data, and it's one specific person's data. You can have more than one argument, and you can also have aliasing of fields, which means that this is actually probably one of the most important and compelling features of GraphQL, which is that if you typically use a JSON API, and you get your dedicated response payload, what you're going to get is something that you can't really change until you get to the client side, right? So you're kind of hamstrung, because if you want to change the way this is going to show up in your React component or whatever you're building, it's pretty hard to do. You know, you have to do some, you know, basically client-side patching of this and add further logic to the client side. It's not pretty. So instead, if we've got a user of UID1, which we all know is the admin, why don't we just alias it that way? And what comes back is this really nice object with admin. And this is all according to the spec. And so basically, we can also disambiguate between identically named fields, which is really powerful as well. And so as you can see, you can fetch you know, assets of different sizes. These are all sort of really superfluous and you know, outlandish examples. You know, these are not actually like you know, real. You can't, you know, I don't have a server set up where you can you know, make these calls. But there's also this concept of fragments. And fragments are basically you know, an atomic unit that allows you to reuse this, you know, selection sets across multiple places. So we have a fragment called content on page, and that's actually a type object. I'll talk a little bit more about type objects soon. So basically, fragments allow you to keep your document clean when you actually submit it. And you can have basically, you know, based on the type of the type object that you actually have on the server, you can dictate how and what fields get actually sent as part, or you know, are actually included as part of the eventual object. So with that being said, let's go ahead and move forward. So fragments can be nested as well, and I you know, so I want to push ahead a little bit to get to some of the cool stuff, but. Basically, we've got inline fragments as well, and you know, I think that this syntax is very compelling because, you know, one of the things that we always have problems with is the inability to see what's going on. Is the inability from the client side when you know, basically this is the problem with the typical approach to RESTful architectures, which is that if you have a Drupal site and you submit a request that's formatted this way, you're going to get a response that's formatted totally differently. And that, you know, that's kind of, you know, really, really hard to get to sort of wrap your head around sometimes. And so, you know, this really resolves that. And of course, you have fragments that can also be anonymous as well. Now, variables you can have as well. So let's say that you have some dynamic insertion of variables into your query later by, you know, some kind of concatenation that goes on the React side. You can provide that variable, and then that variable is used later during the selection process. And then there's also directives as well. I don't want to get too in the weeds here because I do realize this is probably not too exciting without a live ability to see these in action. But anyways, so directives, you know, you can use them to include and exclude fields, to, you know, based on certain parameters such as, and so this is really interesting because it basically, you know, applies kind of programmability into this process. You can do things like skip. You know, you've got all these opportunities to actually hook into the way the query is going to be sent. And so this is very important because, you know, we want to keep our separation of concerns, right? And basically, you don't want any of this to sort of leach into your client-side application. You want this to be dynamic. You want this to be something that is reusable. And so that, you know, this is what that gives you. Okay, so let's move on to mutations because I think that's one of the more important topics here. Now, there's still a lot of debate about this syntax in the GraphQL community, which is about this idea of basically this mutation action. And one of the things to remember here is that it's a very different syntax from the query syntax in that the top level field that you have here, the favorite article, is the only thing that doesn't resolve. That doesn't resolve idempotently, right? So that means that every time you fetch your favorite count on your node, you're always going to get the same one, no matter how many times you perform the operation. However, when you actually perform the mutation operation, that does change what's on the server, right? So what this is doing right now is it's saying, let me do my favorite article action on article ID 992, and then fetch the favorite count afterwards. As I said at the very beginning of this syntax crash course, the actual write operation is favorite article, and then everything inside of it is just a read. It's just a fetch. So what we get in return is this. And as you can see, there's no top level field anymore. We don't see that come back. And this is where the heart of the controversy lies, which is, well, didn't we just talk about how the JSON payload has to look exactly the same as what was sent? what is going on here, right? So there's still a lot of discussions going on about that. Now, this mutation in particular basically supplies a new title to a particular node before fetching the new title. So what you get back, before the mutation, you get that, and then you update the title and you get that. Okay, so we've gotten that out of the way. And mutations are still a very sort of immature part of GraphQL, and obviously still being talked about quite a bit. But I want to talk a lot right now about the type and schema, the type system and schema introspection that we have in GraphQL, which is probably the most interesting and the most compelling feature, and is really applicable to Drupal. So in GraphQL, you can define your schema. And these schemas actually, are meant for query validation. They're meant to tell you what types it supports, what directives you have available. And so basically, Facebook recommends that a GraphQL server generally should have these base types, these scalar types. If you don't have these, basically, anyone who writes a typical GraphQL query might run into some problems. Now you have these things called type objects. So basically, when you declare a type object within your GraphQL schema, now, once again, I want to say we've switched gears here. We've gone away from the actual query document of GraphQL, which is what you saw contained in that React component, and now we've moved to the actual definition of the schema. Now, this type object basically dictates the types that are valid to be sent as part of the request, and then also gives you, that's meant to be returned. And then it gives you basically a really nice way to introspect what you're looking at. Now you can get this output from GraphQL, and I'll show you exactly how to do that in just a second. So types can refer to other objects that you've created. So if you've got something some other object that you want to refer to. But the thing is, that's what's important is that if a type object is nested within another type object, some field has to be selected within that object. So related in this case is type object node, is type node, and it assumes that you've got something, a field inside there that's basically required. So that's a valid query, but this one is not. So object field arguments, this is where you define your arguments, so on and so forth. You've got your, you can provide a validator for this and get all of this wrapped up into your GraphQL server. If you know object-oriented PHP, this might be familiar looking, which is that you can have basically reusable, I really don't want to call them classes, but interfaces, which basically give you a means to do basically what was already done previously with fragments. Types that are invoked within type objects can refer to these interfaces, and then you've got more introspection. So this is where fragments come in, which is that on node syntax refers to the actual type. And you can basically say, hey, if this type is a node, give me the body. All right, one of the last things I want to cover with this is unions, which is really interesting because you can basically provide different types of objects as part of the response, right? Which is very interesting from the standpoint of basically allowing this flexibility and having a single endpoint. You really want to be able to take in any input and give the output that it really wants. So in this case, what's going on is if what comes in is a node type is of type node, we're going to give you these fields. If it's a if it's a taxonomy term, and I'm using these Drupal terms really loosely here, and if it's a taxonomy term, we're going to give you the title and the overarching vocabulary that surrounds it. So what that means is that we can actually write fragments according to that type bifurcation and actually give you a selection process, which basically gives you that. And so you can actually write these really powerful queries without having to do any extra work. You can have exhaustive introspection of the schema. How do you do that? You basically submit a query the same way that it should work. When it comes to any REST API, you should be able to introspect any REST API. But instead, GraphQL has this built into the specification, so you actually get an idea of what's going on. And so this returns this really nice output, which gives you full introspection into the types, into what types are declared, and how the hierarchy works. And then you can also use the underscore underscore schema field as well. So Anyway, so I thought that was a really quick introduction. I didn't want to stick too much to the syntax because it's not something that's really applicable right now. But I just wanted to give you a look at how nice and how easy this is for someone who's a front-end developer. I come from a front-end development background, and I know very very well how hard it is for front-enders and back-enders to come together into the same room and play a game of chess. No, I'm just kidding. But you know what I mean. Basically, we really want front-enders and back-enders to play nicely, and GraphQL is an abstraction that allows this to take place. Give me the data I want. Simple as that. All right, so now I want to sort of delve into what we're really concerned about to finish things off, which is, what does this mean for Drupal, right? So we've talked about what this means for React, what this means for all these other things. What does this mean for Drupal? Well, so if you know Sebastian Siemssen, he works for Zen Stations out in Austria. He was featured in the Barcelona keynote by Dries, and he's currently working on a GraphQL module for Drupal 8 using the native MD system and the type data API that we have in Drupal 8. Now, if you navigate to this URL, you will see the sort of beginnings of that module. Unfortunately, it has not been updated in a couple months, and it's still missing the most important part, which is an underlying low-level PHP library, which actually helps to bridge the gap between Drupal and providing these responses. So that I highly encourage you to check out. There's a lot of interesting work going on there. And the module is not currently installable, but it will soon be on GitHub. Now, if you're interested in actually debugging some of these queries, if you have an existing server, such as that Rising Stack server for GraphQL, or you want to set this up on your own on, let's say, a MongoDB database or what have you, you can use Graphical, which is a GUI for testing and debugging queries. And I'll show you what that looks like at the very end here. Oh, well, right here. Let's do that. So, let me just go. Okay, come on. Okay, so let me just. How do I full screen this here? All right, so let me just give you a quick tour. This is the same video that was presented at DrupalCon Barcelona, but this goes to show how easy this can be. So what we've got here is we've got a bunch of nodes that have been created in Drupal 8, which are basically DrupalCon events, right? They're content type event. And they've got certain custom fields, including city, region, and year. And what we really want is we want to have a really good way to actually go in and look at these node objects. So here's the graphical testing interface. And as you can see, we're writing a query that selects an entity, and it goes through the entity system, and it gets the node of ID3, and it gets the value of the title. And as you can see, this is the JSON payload that comes back. Now, what we want to do is let's query a view. Let's go in, and this is the default admin/content view of Drupal, by the way. And now we've got all of our various titles of all of our nodes, which are basically the Drupal cons that have occurred in the past. Now, let's supply an argument, which is let's just get those conferences which took place in Europe. And if we apply that argument, what you'll see is that now it's limited to just Amsterdam, Prague, Munich, London. There's no there's no Washington, D.C. in there. There's no Denver in there, for example. And then what we can do is using our type system, entity node conference is a type within the GraphQL schema, we can actually get some custom fields out as well. And so what you see here is we're selecting the city, the year, and we're getting these really nice results. And as you can see, if you think about this from the context of a front developer, this is actually really easy to traverse and work with. You're not really dealing with a whole lot of other data that you have to figure out how to parse out. And then we can also select the user as well. So really cool stuff. And I think that's almost the, oh yeah, and then this last thing is just a quick demo of the aliasing ability, which changes that UID field name to be author in the response payload. So this is really cool. I mean, how awesome was that, right? And this is without even having seen like how this would actually look on the client side and how you would actually work with this. But so let me just get out of here so we can go back to the slides here. So what are the next steps, right? We've seen how cool this is. We've seen what a great idea this could really be for Drupal. Well, the next steps for the module are access control, mutation support, the ability to configure these schemas and types using, let's say, YAML, maybe, or an actual UI within Drupal. So with this in mind, what's the future of GraphQL? Well, this is only the first step. The spec is still in heavy flux. The last update was in October 2015, so this is still a very, very fast-moving target. Features are still being added to it. It's still in a lot of flux. Between when I first started writing the presentation, in fact, and when I gave it at BatCamp, things had changed already in the spec. And let me tell you, rewriting a whole deck is no fun. So Facebook is currently in the process of rolling out a whole bunch of tools, which are really good for GraphQL. You know about Relay, you know about this stuff. They're open sourcing a lot of these tools to add and put more energy into the Facebook open source ecosystem, which encompasses React and Relay and all these great ideas. In recent days, or that should be recent months, WebSocket support was announced, and I'm not sure where this has gone quite yet. I need to look into this myself, but should be pretty interesting from the real-time standpoint. Now, what about what we're really worried about, which is how we can actually use this, which is decoupled Drupal? Well, basically, anyone who's using a React application that's backed by a Drupal backend will see your benefit happen immediately, because this is fully integrated into the React ecosystem. You can use this right now with Relay. If you have a Flux implementation that you're using with React, you can use this right now. There's nothing stopping you. But also, since GraphQL is transport agnostic and also framework agnostic, you can use Angular, you can use Ember. As long as you put all the pieces together and send the query, you can make this work with any sort of front end that you want. And this is what's really the most powerful idea of GraphQL, which is I want any front end to be able to query any backend, and you get this sort of common abstraction that lies above all of these things. So you don't have to worry about the fact that you're using SOAP for something versus HTTP, or you're using some other protocol. There's a whole lot of interesting possibilities here. In a single bootstrap, Drupal could serve these really intelligently formed responses that are really tightly catered to your needs. And of course, the same server can interpret many different query structures. It's the same idea. Now, I want to open this up for a little bit of discussion because I think that's what I think a lot of us are really curious about where this could go and where the sort of future directions of this technology and this idea goes. What is the future of technologies like GraphQL? Well, so some of you might have heard of Netflix's Falcor. How many of you have heard of Falcor? Okay, so Falcor takes a very different approach. Falcor puts a lot more of the onus of actually batching these queries and making them performant on the client side, which means that from the client side, you put in some sort of logic. It's path-based, which means that you're, basically Falcor gives you the ability to call from multiple paths and consolidate those queries. Now, I don't know a whole lot about Falcor. Maybe someone else can speak to it, but there's a lot of discussions going on right now about which is the better approach, right? Should we put another abstraction on top, or should we put more of the onus on the client side to actually, resolve these differences? And should there really be an abstraction like this, further, because it, once again, adds more overhead. You got to, have your GraphQL server, all of that stuff. What is the future of web services in Drupal in light of GraphQL? So this is currently being worked on right now in the Drupal 8 module GraphQL. Basically what it does is it just lies on top of the REST server. It gives you a JSON payload, typical JSON response out of Drupal. But what's coming back obviously is an interpretation of the response coming from the interpretation of that GraphQL query. So what is the future of decoupled CMS architectures in the front end with GraphQL? And what's the future of RESTful architectures in general and the server-client relationship in light of GraphQL? Well, there's a lot of interesting debate going on right now with the advent of these IoT applications or Internet of Things applications, where the response payload, the size of the response payload, becomes a really, really important factor in performance. Things like GraphQL are really interesting. These ideas are very interesting. The idea of being able to query anything you want to from any client you want to is a very interesting and compelling one. Hello? So this is just some food for thought. I wanted to pose these questions sort of out in the open, just because this is a very active space. This is a very sort of fast-moving space. And I think there's a lot of potential for some really exciting work to be done here in the future. So with that in mind, thank you very much. I hope this was useful. Thank you.
Woo! All right, thank you. Does anybody have any questions for Preston? We have one here, we have one here.
Yes, Mike.
So I have lots of questions, but a couple of things. So I've been working with the open source world for 15 years, and I've seen lots of progress done and lots of progress done. This sort of Facebook ecosystem is an interesting sort of hybrid that reminds me a lot in a very troubling way of Adobe, where part of it was open and part of it isn't. And then something they decide to change something on their back end, like they're using GraphQL for their database, for their graph database. And they may decide they want to change it for, you know, some arbitrary reason. And you may know that they just canceled the Parse project, you know, sort of out from under everybody.
Yep.
So it's really tricky dealing with these companies that have their own agenda. React, I think, is interesting because it's gone through a sort of two or three iterations where they're now completely open source, not just versions of React, but improvements on React, like Redux, for example. So I think this is really interesting. What I would suggest is working very closely with the JSON API people, which is another very mature JSON-based web services system. And there's a lot of smart people like Yehuda Katz behind that. And just try to take the really good parts of GraphQL and build them into something that is truly independent of Facebook. And because otherwise you can get burned in a variety of ways unexpectedly.
Yeah, that was a very good question. So the question had to do with sort of the open source and proprietariness of GraphQL and the whole React ecosystem. And I think this is a very important debate that's been going on. So the first response I would have to that is that GraphQL is very much open source in the sense that they've released their spec, right? So there's a spec document you can actually go to, which, you know, lists out all the language features. And, you know, it doesn't look like something that's going to be pulled anytime soon. And, you know, once again, you know, GraphQL is completely backend agnostic. It's not meant to be something that is tied to a particular, you know, server implementation or architecture. It's really meant to be flexible. However, that being said, I do definitely see the concern. There's been a very, very large debate raging right now in the React community, actually, about their licensing. And this is a, you know, so if you don't know, if you're not familiar, React is licensed under BSD, and is also there's also a patents clause hidden within this licensing, which basically states that if you sue Facebook for any unrelated reason, if you sue Facebook because they violated your privacy, they have the right to revoke your access to React. Which means that if you have an application and you're, I don't know, like, you know, like Oracle or something, and you decide to sue Facebook for some completely arbitrary, unrelated reason, let's say you've got a patent, they can revoke your access and you have to shut down all your React applications. So this has been a GitHub issue on the WordPress Calypso project, which uses React, and also on the React project itself. People are very concerned about the implications of this on open source projects and on open source in general. So I think it's you know, the answer I would say is that it's kind of mixed, right? We see Facebook being very open source and keeping up with the open source ethos by releasing the spec and encouraging people to build off of the spec, but then we see sort of this, you know, other, you know, this sort of, you know, other side of them, which says, well, actually, we don't want you to use our stuff completely according to your own ideas. So I hope that answers at least some of that question.
All right, we have one question there, and then we have one right here.
Okay, hey. This is Scott. My question is, I know you were describing how Drupal could be used as a server in this, according to the spec. And I was thinking maybe that was more of a proof of concept than an actual end goal reality. And my question to you is, so there's a spec and there are servers, essentially. How does caching work with this kind of querying? Because it sounds like every query is different. You know, in this sense, you're not really hitting endpoints with some sort of a TTL, or you're not really hitting, you know, you're not combining known reusable queries. You're literally just like giving a different kind of package every time. So I'm curious what the caching strategies are, except for like a highly performant server. Or maybe that is the answer, but I'm curious. Thanks.
Sure, that's a very good question. And I'm going to preface that by saying I'm not a caching expert, so I'm probably the wrong person to ask that question. But you know, from my sort of cursory reading on the subject, what people are saying is that, you know, you're going to need to have caching both on the client side and the server side. Basically, if you have a bunch of queries that are repeated all the time, that should be cached somewhere on the client side. And then the server also has to be intelligent about what it's serving as well. So, you know, the sort of, I apologize for the sort of incomplete answer, but, you know, the sort of real difference is that now the onus is on both the server and the client side. Does anyone have any exposure to caching in GraphQL?
No.
Yeah, I don't think anyone, this is something that, like, there's no blog post on this yet. Yes.
Yeah, I was just wondering about paging. So, you know, obviously if I said, give me the users and I have a billion users, I don't want one list of a billion users. So is that built into the spec?
As far as I know, the way to do that is through arguments and through that, right? You give basically an argument that's something like count, and the GraphQL implementation on the server side will interpret that and say, hey, you only want 10. However, the paging is very, because you want to be able to get page 10, let's say, of 500 pages. That's something that I actually am not quite sure of. You know, definitely something to explore as a problem space. I believe Falcor has a solution for paging. I may be mistaken about that, but
other questions?
Anyone? All right. Thank you very much, Preston. Woo! Okay, a couple things before we wrap up. Even before we get to the next meetup, this is just a quick reminder. Before you go to sleep tonight, make sure that you go to the Drupal NYC, Drupal Camp NYC, and sign up and come to the unconference. It's going to be unreal. That's right, I thought of that out there. took me an hour. Okay. Okay, our next meetup is going to be on Wednesday, March 2nd. That is the first Wednesday of the month. We're on a pretty regular schedule now of first Wednesdays of the month, which is great. It will be here in this room. The sign-up process should be the same, where you go to the guest services like you did today and get your little fun tag and do all that good stuff. But please do remember to, you know, go on Meetup and sign up ahead of time so that they have your name and that you can come. You have a question about that? So the question is, do we already have somebody to do these intro to Drupal? So we do have some people signed up, but if you are interested, you should definitely talk to Ben Jevons in the back, and he will he'll get you involved. If you have an intro to Drupal idea, you got 10 minutes, you want to do something, let us know. Ben is your man. Good question. But we are focusing specifically in the next meetup on some intro to Drupal topics. I'll be doing one on views. Someone else is going to do one on Git. In the LAMP stack. I'm pretty sure we have at least one or two others already in the hopper. But please, if you have ideas or you have something real specific that you want to hear about, talk to Ben and let him know. Tell your friends, tell your neighbors, tell your colleagues, tell your boss. And after party, Bill's Bar downstairs. Enter on 51st Street. We should be downstairs at the downstairs bar. No, we're at the upstairs. I'm being told by management that we're going to be at the upstairs bar. The upstairs bar. Okay. That's it. Everybody get out. No, I'm kidding. Thank you, everybody. Thank you to our speakers. Thank you to our organizers. We will see every last one of you bringing a friend here next meetup, Wednesday, the 2nd of March. Bring your friends. Bring your neighbors.
Okay. So I missed the first one.